All right, let's turn in our Bibles to Acts 14. Acts chapter 14. Does anyone need the handouts today? Are the same ones as last week's? So if you've lost last week's, you're in trouble. You have to pay for the second one. So, Tom, can, there should be a stack of them over here. If you could pass some of those out, please. I'm surprised you guys could lose these over a week, because these, I think you would just be treasuring them daily. No. Anybody else need a handout? Tom, get one right up here, please. I'm off. We're good. You guys were looking for shock value this morning. You got it. So thank you. It was definitely a shock, but I appreciate it. Thank you very much. It's good to be back. I'll share more of that tonight. God protects. Sometimes we don't even know what he's doing, and he does it. And I'm very thankful that he's faithful. Okay, Acts chapter 14. Now let's do some catch-up work. At this point in our text, Acts 13 and 14, this is the text where we have Paul's first missionary journey. That's kind of how Acts is all broken up for us. We have the first, second, third missionary journey. We see him going to Rome. We know what happens as he goes to Rome, and traditions explains how he was killed there. But right now, we're in this first missionary journey. We're right in the middle of it. So what I want to do is take a look at this map. There we go. So I don't know how much of this I have shared with you, but we're going to catch you up fast. They started here at Antioch, and if you remember, we have Antioch here, we have Antioch up here, and the Roman guy that decided, the general, loved his dad and decided he's going to name 16 cities Antioch after his father. So we got a bunch of Antiochs. So he left Antioch, came down to Seleucia, and went across to Cyprus. Now, if you notice here, you see the straight line that goes from Cyprus over to Paphos. I have a hard time believing that Paul traveled in this straight line. And to give you a frame of reference, what we're going to be looking at today is this line. And that little line there is about 80 miles. Here, it was probably about 80 to 100. And most likely, when Paul went across Cyprus, he did more like this and went all through that island, teaching people the gospel. And we saw some really good results. And after they left here from Paphos, they came over to Perga. And this is the area where they had some hardships. This is where John Mark decided, this isn't for me. This is not what I signed up for. And whatever the reasonings, he left. And he took a boat from here back down in this area, down to Jerusalem. He went back home. So that's kind of where they were at that point. And then they went up through this treacherous area up to Antioch, if you remember. And that was treacherous with bandits. It was treacherous with the terrain. This was a hard area that Paul decided they were going to go up through and to go and minister. So this is what's going on in their lives around this time. As they got to Antioch. Antioch was a key area because this is where they saw some results. They saw some really good results. Things were going very, very well with them. And then we saw the envy. Remember that of the Jewish leaders? They saw all these Jews, all these potential proselytes coming into them to hear them. And it roused up this envy that they were having. And because of that, they kicked them out of town. They had them leave. And as soon as Paul and Barnabas were kicked out of town, they made this trek of about 4 days' journey to come over to Iconium. At Iconium, this is where people were converted by, they're just multitudes. People were being converted, and we're told they stayed there a long time. That's what we were looking at last time. And there was a division that came up, and that's what the gospel does. The gospel causes division. And this division that came up, it turned into a mob. And this group, this mob, they were coming. They were coming after Paul and Barnabas, and they were going to stone them. Paul and Barnabas escaped. And that brings us to the passage that we're at today. One of the things you'll notice as we look at passages like this is that things are starting to intensify. There are times that we can have verbal opposition. They had this. But then it started becoming more of a threatening and a intimidation. And it's going to this pattern is going to continue. It's going to get worse and worse, and it's going to intensify. So what I want to do with you today is I'll catch you up for those who don't have the notes from last time. We'll review the points very quickly, and then we'll get started into our new text. So let's go ahead and start with our first point from last time, the ministry in Iconium. As we mentioned, they traveled. Yeah, I don't have it up there. That's my fault. They traveled that line across from Antioch to Iconium. That was about an 80-mile trek. So the area they're going to is an extremely pagan area. It's people who, I don't know else to say it, they're pagan. They don't know the gospel. They don't care about the gospel. And that's the area that they go to. So we see first the initial reception. They went back to the Jews. We went over that last time. And as they went back, there was Jews and Gentiles, but there was a great number of people that became followers of Jesus in this city. Then we saw the intervention. The intervention of the unsaved. What happens is very similar to what happened previously in Antioch. The Jews came, and the wording that you can use is they poisoned their minds. The Jews came and they sowed that discord. They caused the people to become embittered against Paul and Barnabas. And we can do this today. We can say things that causes others to become embittered towards others. It's sin. No matter how you slice it, it's a sinful thing. That's what's happening here. So that's how the intervention was happening. Then we saw the increased hostility. The increased hostility. We're told in verses 3-6, they stayed there a bunch of days. And here's what we learned from that. Paul and Barnabas were not backing down because things got tough. They weren't backing down because people weren't receiving them. They were patting them on the back. So they weren't going to quit. And what the scripture here tells us that they, in verse 3, they spoke boldly. If you flip over to the backside of your handout, that was the first trait that we had down for these character traits of an effective follower of Jesus. And please listen to this. Those character traits, this is not something that I'm putting here so that when we have a missionary or leaders being recommended, you're not looking at that for them. It's not, okay, those people should have these character traits. This is character traits for you and me. This is what we are supposed to be as Christians. And I challenge you, as we go through these, ask yourself, how am I measuring up to God's list? These are points that God chooses to bring up about his servants that you and I need to be emulating. This is something that's good for us. So the first trait that we saw on this list was boldness. And Paul was speaking boldly. But even though you've got God himself, I mean, think about that. God himself is working here. God is confirming. We saw in this passage, it mentions as well, the miracles were being done. Excuse me. Even though God is working and God is showing himself power, there's still this major division. And we're told in verses 5 and 6 that there was that assault made. You remember that word is also used with the rushing of the pigs down the hill when the maniac had the legion of demons cast out. That's the word we had, that they rushed down the hill. That's the word here where they assaulted him. Not a beating, they were just rushing them. They were going after Paul and Barnabas, and their intent was, into that verse, to stone them. They wanted to kill them. That is the intention that the people had. And then Paul and Barnabas, somehow they became aware of it, and they took off. So that brings you to your application statement we had at the bottom. You and I need to be actively available to get involved in intentionally making disciples. If you're wondering why I keep using those words, it's because those words are important. Actively doing something is not just, well, if it comes, it comes. intentionally making disciples is not, well, if somebody comes and asks me, I'll talk to them. You and I need to be in this battle. We need to jump in with all of our being to try to make disciples. It may involve some persecution, but that is to be expected. Let's ask God to help us to be bold as we witness and persevere in serving him. Okay, there's your points. And that brings us to where we are this week. Today, what we're going to see Paul and Barnabas. They're going to leave and head for Lystra. I don't know if it's Lystra or Lystra, but I'll probably do it both ways. Bear with me. They're going to leave for Lystra and Derbe. And we're going to see God is obviously blessing. God is helping in their lives. He's helping in the ministry. And we're going to see as that happens, opposition is going to come. And this is like a repeat constantly. Opposition is going to come and Paul is going to persevere. That is his character traits. So let's have a word of prayer and we'll look at our text. Father, thank you for your goodness. Thank you for loving us. God, I ask you for your help this morning. Lord, I pray that you would work in us, that we would hear your word, we would understand your word, we would desire to obey your word. Father, where there is resistance against you in any way, would you please open our eyes? Help us to see where we are, what needs to change, and Lord, do a work in us this morning. I pray as we go through these verses that you would please give me clear thoughts, help me to remember your word, to teach it accurately. Please help me not to be a distraction. Lord, I pray most of all that you would glorify yourself in some way by our time here this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. First point, the ministry. Or this is the second point on your handout. The ministry in Laconia. Now, Laconia, that is it's like a state. If you have Galatia as the whole region, there was, you know, subsections of it would be like a state today, multiple cities within this area. Laconia is one of those areas within, I'm going to call it the state of Galatia. So it's a large area, multiple cities, and they have multiple opportunities here to spread the gospel. There's also going to be a lot more opposition. So first thing we're going to see, they left for Lystra. They left for Lystra, verses 6 and 7. They were aware of it. Okay, this is going back to what we covered last time. They were aware of this attempt to kill them, and they fled unto Lystra and Derbe, cities of Laconia, under the region that lies round about, and under the region that lies round about. And there they preached the gospel. So again, we've got the map up here. Just notice where they went. They came. Need that map. There we go. They left Iconium and came down. Now, you'll notice how short this was. It's like a day's trip down to Lystra. They came down this far, and that's the area where they're going to be, I'm going to call it camping out for a while. See, Lystra is the first one they go to. And one of the things we don't see here as we're going through this is you don't see a synagogue. Normally, Paul's practice was, I'm going to go to the Jew first. That's what he would practice. Here, we don't have that. But we know there were some Jews. If you look back in scripture, you're going to see Timothy. And Timothy, this is where he's from. Timothy from Lystra. So we know there's some Jews there. But here's what I want you to notice. I want you to notice what they do. Look in verse 7. There they preach the gospel. Now think about that for just a second. What is it that got Paul and Barnabas in trouble in the first place in the last cities they were in? Preaching the gospel. What is it that generated this opposition against them? Preaching the gospel. And what are we told they're doing? Again, they're preaching the gospel. And the tense that we have with this word is they were just constantly over and over and over preaching the gospel. That is what's getting them in trouble, but they keep doing it. Now, this is the word we have here is from the backside of your handout, perseverance. There's your second character trait. They are persevering. Now, I could have put this trait pretty much anywhere in Paul's life. This is his character. No matter what came, Paul just kept on persevering. And he does this for the rest of his life. He would not quit. And get this point. He would not quit doing what the Lord desired. Regardless, Paul continued on despite the oppositions, despite the hardships. Paul kept, keep on keeping on. He kept on keeping on. That is what Paul was doing. The whole purpose of the persecution was, Paul, we want you to stop this. But the persecution had the opposite effect. Paul, it intensified Paul's zeal. You realize that's been, it's really like a standard in a sense. As you look through history, through the centuries, the church, when it's persecuted, it normally grows. Persecution does not stop the church of God. Persecution intensifies people's zeal. And this is opinion. This is not scripture, what I'm telling you. My opinion is because it weeds out the tares. It weeds out those who don't really care, those who are just in it for themselves. And I would suggest that our country has a whole bunch of tares. It weeds them out, and the serious ones get more excited about the things of God and more intensified in their passion to serve God. That's what happens. Preaching the gospel with Paul, I would say it wasn't so much a thing that he did as much as a part of who he was. Paul was a follower of Jesus, and get this, followers of Jesus preach the gospel. Not just certain positions, followers of Jesus preach the gospel. Now, am I saying to you that if you're not out proclaiming the gospel, you're not a follower of Jesus? I don't know that I can go that far, but I will go this far. You're not an obedient follower of Jesus. If you're not proclaiming the word of God intentionally and desiring to have an impact with that book, there is something between you and Jesus that's your fault. And you're wrong. You are in sin if you are purposefully resisting and rejecting God's call for our lives and his commission on us. We must do this. That's what Paul was actively doing. He had a passion to see souls saved. He had a passion to make disciples. How did he get this? Okay, let's take that to us. How do we get this? How do we get this passion? Maybe you're sitting there today thinking, okay, well, I want to, but I'm not excited about it. How do I get God to help me with this? Here's what Paul did. He yielded his life to the Holy Spirit. That's what he did. And what is the parallel passage. We've covered this before. Let Colossians 3:16, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom. That's how we have the filling of the Holy Spirit. We take his word. We let it dwell in us. We obey it. We follow it. That's when we're going to see God working in mighty ways in our lives. Here's what happens. Making disciples brings glory to Jesus. It does. That's what he commanded. That's what he desired. That's what he wants. And doing that brings him glory. So he wants to be glorified. And I'll tell you what, when you start saying, God, I want to glorify you, help me to have this passion to make disciples, empower me, give me wisdom. When you start having that desire, he honors this. And he will empower. He does empower. As you and I are active in actively trying to participate in that process. Paul had some experiences that you and I haven't had, that we're not gonna have. But you and I have the exact same Holy Spirit working in us, empowering us, helping us. There is no difference. There's nothing that's gonna stop us from doing what the Lord desires except for us. Let's not be in that camp. So let's let the Holy Spirit lead and let's follow him. Point B, the lame man is healed. Start with verse 8. And there sat a certain man at Lystra, impotent in his feet, being a cripple from his mother's womb, who never had walked. The same heard Paul speak, who steadfastly beholding him and perceiving he had faith to be healed, said with a loud voice, stand upright on your feet. And he leaped and he walked. Now, Luke is we know Luke was the physician. He's very particular about some things when he's penning these words. And this is one of those instances. In that first verse, in verse 8, Luke makes exceptionally clear this man's condition. It says he's impotent in the feet. There is no possibility of this man walking. It's just an impossibility. He says it's from the womb. I mean, from birth, this man had this issue. So he's intensifying it. And then the third thing he puts, he never walked. He's just adding emphasis upon emphasis to show one thing about this man's condition. He was hopeless. This man was hopeless. There was nothing that can be done. And then we see verse 9. This man heard. Now, the tense of that, over and over and over. Okay, that tells us Paul had been there preaching. Paul had been giving the gospel. And the word here for the heard is not, you know, I'm sitting down the street and I'm hearing a commotion down here. This is the word that would be he heard with understanding. In other words, he got it. He got it. This man heard and received the gospel. And somehow, I don't know how, we're not told, Paul understood, perceived that this man had faith to be healed. And the faith went with the healing. But this man had heard, he had accepted. And God allowed that to happen. And God is going to allow Paul in this passage to heal this man. He is going to, and here's you'll understand this, I think. He is going to confirm the message that Paul's preaching. He's going to confirm the messenger as being his messenger by doing this miraculous event, by doing this apostolic miracle. That's what's happening in this passage. So this man, this lame man, is transitioning in these verses from hearing about Jesus to believing it for himself personally. So in verse 10, we have Paul saying, you know, he commands him, stand up. And by faith, this man, he didn't just stand, he leaps. Now, notice how similar, if you remember back, Acts chapter 3, you remember when Peter healed the lame man then? These two passages are like mirrors to each other. They are exceptionally close in the way that they're done and the reaction that happens. And I would like to throw this out, but that being the case, it shows us Paul was no less than Peter as an apostle. These are apostolic miracles that are happening. And Paul is coming in, I'm going to say, on equal par with Peter. They have the same abilities, if you will, the same blessing from God. Now, we know that the sign gifts, as you start reading on through the book of Acts, we're going to notice that those sign gifts are going to lessen and lessen and lessen as we start receiving the word of God given to us. We don't need, at this point, we don't need somebody to come along and confirm the message of this book. This book confirms itself. This book is, God's big enough to stand up for himself, and this book is true. We just proclaim this truth. I don't need a sign for you to know, okay, is this guy preaching what's right? You need to be Bereans, look into the scripture and see if it's right or not. We have the truth of the word of God. So what we need to do is be accurately proclaiming it. So that's our job. Point C, the love expressed. Love expressed. Now I use love because I wanted to get my alliteration going, but what I meant by love is worship. Worship is expressed in these verses. Look at verse 11. And when the people saw what Paul had done, they lifted up their voices, saying in the speech of Laconia, the gods are come down to us in the likeness of men. And they called Barnabas Jupiter and Paul Mercurius, because he was the chief speaker. Then the priest of Jupiter, which was before their city, brought oxen and garlands under the gates and would have done sacrifice unto the people. I used to read these verses and I would think, you know, why? Why would they just pick these random gods to call Barnabas and Paul by their names? Well, it wasn't random. There was history to this. There's some backgrounds. Let me just fill you in on that real quick with these two gods. And why offer them sacrifice? These pagans were extremely superstitious people. And here was the legend that they had. And obviously, it's not truth. It was a legend. But here's their legend. Back in the day, they believed, Zeus and Hermes No, they're not in here. You'll see why in a sec. But Zeus and Hermes took on the likeness of men. They came down to Lystra. They were in that area, and they went knocking on doors, about 1,000 doors, trying to get people to let them in, to take care of them, to help them. And everybody said, no. No one would help the gods come in human form until he finally got to this one poor elderly couple. And this couple, their names were Philemon and Baucis. They didn't have much stuff, very meager supplies, but they provided for Zeus and Hermes, and the gods liked that. But the gods didn't appreciate being shunned by all the people, so they brought a flood. They wiped out 1,000 homes that didn't help them. They made that shack into this huge temple. And when that couple died, I don't know why they would want this, but they made him into two big oak trees. Okay, there is the legend that these people are looking at. And here's what's happening. They're saying the gods have come again, and we don't want to have this same thing happen to us. We don't want to get wiped out because we don't receive the gods the way that our ancestors didn't receive them. So as you look at this, they call Barnabas Jupiter. Okay, that's the Roman name for Zeus. He was the leader. He was the one that was like behind the scenes leading things. They called Paul Mercury, that's the Roman name for Hermes. He was the speaker, the orator, the eloquent one. So this is the history of why they're doing this. And then so this priest comes along. He wants to make sure we don't mess up the gods of this world. We don't mess up what's going on. So I'm going to offer sacrifices, and I'm going to make sure that these guys are extremely happy with us, so we don't get wiped out again. So, all this is happening, and they're speaking, we're told here, in the language of Laconia. And so Paul and Barnabas are kind of clueless. They're just sitting back watching all this commotion going on. Well, it says all of a sudden they started to get it. They started understanding this is what is going on. Now, one of the things I want you to notice here is the fact that it is an innate desire of people to worship something. There is an innate thing in people that we know that there is something beyond us. We know that we should be worshiping, and these people were no different. And here's what they were doing. They were just worshiping what they had been taught. They've been receiving this all these years. They had this desire to worship. What they needed was truth. They needed the truth. This is no different than us today. We got people all over the place who are worshiping something. Now, in our culture, one of the things that I see people worshiping often is just self. We serve our intellect. How many times do we hear, oh, I trust science, falsely, so-called. People are going to worship their intellect. They're going to worship self. And those who would be saying they're on the religious spectrum, what we see people worshiping so often is this perversion of Jesus. We get this picture of Jesus in our culture today. Jesus is taught as the one that you need to give your allegiance to because he's going to do good things for you. He's going to make you healthy, wealthy, wise. He's going to give you all the stuff that you need, and he's going to meet your wishes. He's just like this Santa Claus type picture, and nothing's further from the truth. That whole mentality, it really is very similar to the self-worship because it's all about me. And people, it's not all about us. It's all about Jesus. It's all about us worshiping him, us lifting him up. Any movement, any teaching if it makes Jesus anything other than Lord, if it makes Jesus anything other than the supreme authority that we are accountable to, if Jesus is anything other than the only one deserving of our worship, of our following, of our allegiance, it's sinful. It is out of the will of God, and it should not be followed. Jesus is what it's all about. It's us serving him being Lord. That's not what most see today. It's not what most teach and hear today. So you and I need to be making disciples and teaching truth. Notice the reaction we have, the lament of the missionaries. The lament of the missionaries. They weren't understanding what was going on. It's a different language, but when they got it, they got it. Look in verse 14. Which when the apostles, Barnabas and Paul, heard of, they rent their clothes, they ran in among the people, crying out and saying, "Sir, what are you doing? Why are you doing this stuff? We are also men of like passions with you. We preach unto you that you should turn from these vanities. You should turn to the living God, which made heaven and earth and the sea and all things that are therein, who in time past suffered all nations to walk in their own ways. Nevertheless, he left not himself without witness, in that he did good and gave us rain from heaven and fruitful seasons, filling our hearts with food and gladness. And with these sayings, barely he restrained the people, that they had not done sacrifice unto them." So this is the picture that we have with them hearing this worship and how they react. Now, can you see the temptation that would have been there for Paul? It could have been a temptation to say, "Oh, these people like me. These people think we're something special. If we just kind of, shut our mouths, receive this adoration, we can get anything we want. They're going to give us anything." There could have been a temptation. I would say for them, a stronger temptation might have been something like this. Let's receive their adoration. Let's let them think we're something special. And then once they're buttered up to us and everything's really good, we can give them the gospel. And let's throw a spiritual twist to this thing. They didn't do this. Here's what they did. They consciously deflected the gospel, the praise. They constantly turned the glory back to the Lord. That's what you and I are supposed to do. It's got to be an intentional thing. When people start, even when you're witnessing to someone, even when you're working with someone and discipling, there are times people will say, "I just appreciate you so much. You're wonderful. You're wonderful. You're wonderful. You're wonderful." And it's not. We're nothing. We need to consciously deflect that praise back to our Lord. And I like the way that Paul did it when he's saying, "We're just like you. What are you talking about?" He kept turning it back. And the trait we have here, and this is your third one on the back, is humility. It's humility. Life, this is so easy to say and so hard to practice. Life is not all about us. It's just not. Life is not about my happiness. Life is not about my achievements. Life is not about us. Life for a Christian is about bringing glory to our Lord. That's life. That's supposed to be our main underlying purpose that permeates every area of our life, bringing glory to our Lord. And Paul and Barnabas, they were serious about this. We need to be serious about this. Now, let's look through these verses a little closer. Verse 14, it says, we're told they saw all this mess happening and they tore their clothes. We see that all through the Old Testament. We see some in the New Testament. The idea, we're seeing something that is apostate. We're seeing something that is wrong. We're seeing something that's troubling us. And this is how we're going to show it. I can't imagine those clothes bills when we see that. That'd be expensive. But they tore their clothes. They're showing a visible symbol that we are objecting to what you people are doing. They knew worship belongs to God. They knew this. And they wanted no part of even a pseudo worship being pointed at them. So we're told they ran in among the people. They got in among the people to show them their sin. It would not have worked had they stood back and said, let's just wait for these pagans to come to us and ask us why we're not participating. Let's wait back on the sidelines and see if they're going to see our lifestyle and want to come to us and ask us questions. It wouldn't have worked. It doesn't work today. They ran in among the people. They love the people, but they are showing these people their sin. We need to be serious-minded about getting among people and pointing the lost to Jesus. That needs to be a passion for us. Verse 15. Basically, what he's saying is, what are you people doing? What do you think you're doing? We are men just like you. I've got the same passions. I've got the same sins. I've got the same issues going on in my head. I have this struggle with my flesh just like you've got. There's no way that we are gods. We're not gods. We've been telling you this, middle of that verse. We've been telling you these vanities, these idols that you're worshiping. We've been preaching to you. Get away from those. Repent. Turn to Jesus. Turn to the one true God. And they're pushing this point. Now, we know that Paul has already given the gospel to them. We've seen that lame man that was healed. He heard the gospel. And he heard it over and over and over and over. Paul's been busy giving the gospel. And now he's saying, you need to repent. Turn from your fake gods. Turn from your idols. They're worthless. They're nothing. You need to repent and turn to the one true God, because you can't grab hold of both of them. Matthew 6:24, right? You're going to love one, hate the other, cleave to the one, despise the other. You can't serve God and mammon. You can't serve two. So what he's going to do here, and this is an interesting point, he's going to turn to a general revelation and not to a specific revelation. He doesn't turn here. What I mean by that, he turns to nature instead of scripture. He turns to what is a common grace instead of to the word of God. Now, why would he do that? Do these pagans know the Old Testament? I'm going to say most likely not. They don't have that background. They don't have, it sounds like, the teaching that would help them, which is why you keep going to the Jews first. They don't have this. So what Paul is going to do is he's going to say, look, God is your creator. God is your sustainer. He turns and he meets the people where they are. We can learn from this, okay? This is getting more and more real in our culture. I have heard people who have tried to witness to someone. I'm going to say this as kindly as I can. As though we're back in the 50s and 60s and everybody has this general knowledge of God, and people, it's not there at the time. We need to meet people where they are and help them along and teach them underlying truths to get them to the point sometimes of, look, Jesus is what you need. There needs to, and that's why we push so often, make relationships. These things can come. We can bring these truths up. We need to build that foundation, which is what they were doing before jumping into Jesus alone. Verse 16. In the past, he suffered all these nations to walk in their own way. He allowed these nations to choose to do wrong. He gave them that option. He gave them and allowed them the ability to just go do their own thing. He didn't give them a written law. He did not send the messengers to them. He sent it to his people, and they were supposed to go to the Gentiles. But he didn't give them the law. He didn't give them the messengers. He let them do their own thing. Verse 17, but he still left them a witness. He still left them a witness. And here he's speaking of that common grace that every person, this is Romans 1 as well, that people have. Even though these people were in the process of rebelling against God, of rejecting God, he treated them, this text, the verse says, he treated them good. He did good. Why does he do good? Because he is good. That's what he did. And that's what our God is like. And he brings up, he's the one that provided the rain. Now, did you know in their teaching, Zeus provided rain? God is the one who provided their produce. Hermes is the one that provides produce in their teaching. He's showing them so clearly, God is the true God. The God we're preaching to you is the true God. And here's the point. We represent the one true God, not these fake ones that you're serving. That's the point that they're pushing. Verse 18, Even though we told him all this stuff, even though we showed him all this power, he could barely restrain them to keep them from sacrificing to him. He had a hard time stopping the people. So what Paul's done is he has exposed the truth about idolatry. And he's teaching them, and he writes this down for them in 1 Corinthians 10:14, flee idolatry. He's telling them, you need to flee from this. These gods won't help you. They're vanities. We're going to see this in a moment, but I'm not sure how much time happens between 18 and 19. There's time that happens in there. But here's what we do know. That sacrifice stopped. And the teaching, it just kept on going. It progressed. It continued. As you and I work with people, and I hope that's a passion for you, to desire to give someone the word of God. As we work in people's lives to give them the gospel, it can be easy to get put in a position of honor in the person that you're working with in their eyes. We need to resist that. It's not about us. It's nothing. We don't bring something to the table that they should honor. We're representing the one they should honor. And we need to make sure that they are understanding this. We need to deflect that praise back to our Lord. And we need to remind people that while God lets us make choices, and he does, we're accountable for those choices. There is an accountability for the choices we make and what we do with the revelation that he provides. That's a scary thing. And I would say that applies to anyone in this room who would say, I'm a follower of Christ today. Do you realize that you, this is in some ways negative, you are accountable. The fact that you're here and you are hearing the preaching of the word of God, you're accountable for what you do with what you hear. There is an accountability to whom much is given, much shall be required. So we have the greater teachers have the greater condemnation. You, as hearing this, these passages week in and week out, you are accountable. And that's sobering. It should be sobering. Point E, the lynching of Paul. Now, up to this point, everything's going good. Guy's been healed. People come in to do wrong. Paul stops them. He's giving the gospel. People are being saved. Things are going great. Okay, verse 19. And there came thither certain Jews from Antioch and Iconium who persuaded the people, and having stoned Paul, drew him out of the city, supposing he had been dead. Howbeit the disciples stood round about him. He rose up and he came into the city. Now, again, I'm not sure how much time happened in between verses 18 and 19, but we do know this. There was enough time for people to be hearing the gospel and people to be converted. There was a church starting in this area, and it was a great thing. But I want us to notice just a few things in these verses. First of all, notice how far people will go to show their hatred for the Lord and for his people. When it says here, don't forget this, it said the Jews came from Antioch and Iconium. If you remember that map, Antioch over to Iconium was about 80 miles. Down to Lystra was about 20 miles. Some of these people traveled up to 100 miles to come and try to kill Saul. 100 miles, just understand in our context, that's like a 5-day journey. It's like you or me saying, you know what? I know I live in South Carolina, but I'm going to travel over to California in my car. It's going to take me about 5 days so I can kill this guy. That's what happened. This is a long journey that these guys went on just to show hatred. I read this quote. Guy, last name is Arnold. He wrote this. Unfortunately, haters of Christianity often display more zeal in destroying the faith than lovers of Christianity do in protecting the faith. Bad men will often travel further to do evil than good men will to do good. And wicked men often show more zeal in opposing the gospel than professed Christians do in advancing it. But this was not the case with Paul. The wicked are very active in what they do. The wicked are zealous in their opposition. It should not hold a candle to our zeal if we're a follower of the truth. And another thing we see here is this fickleness. And how many times have we pointed out fickleness in these messages? The fickleness of people. It's a constant theme. They just got finished worshiping these men as gods, acknowledging this is what they did. This is how great they are. We love you. We love you. We love you. Now we're going to kill you. And it was like a change. People can be totally fickle. Let's be careful not to have that said of us. Let's be careful to be faithful to each other. Let's be careful that we love all men, especially those, do good to all men, especially those of the household of faith. Another thing, and this is the main point that I see with these verses. We see the power of God. We see the power of God. You think about this. Paul was stoned. Now, growing up, what I had as rocks was pieces of gravel in our driveway. That's what I would throw. And we threw rocks all the time. We were weird. I mean, we just throw rocks at anything. It was fun. These weren't rocks. These were stones. These were like softball probably size that they could take with jagged edges and hurl at someone. What these men were doing was dangerous, and they knew it. They were attempting and trying to kill Paul. And they were told they drug him out of the city. Don't know what body part they grabbed to drag him. I tell you what, the head was probably bouncing on rocks. They weren't being careful. They thought he was dead. And then Paul turns around and people are standing around him and he gets up. We have a miraculous healing. Some will teach that he was dead and resurrected. I would reject that because Luke makes it real clear. They supposed that he had been dead. When Luke shows a resurrection, it's highlighted. It's a big deal. This one's not highlighted. I would just suggest this was a miraculous healing, but it wasn't a resurrection. Some would disagree. That's fine. Not a major deal. This is the time in 2 Corinthians 11:25 where Paul is going through his list. This is what all happened to me in my journeys. And he mentions, once was I stoned. Okay, this is it. This is the time that he's referring back to. And I'm stepping back into my imagination right now. I can just picture Paul as he's about to be stoned, seeing these men picking up these rocks and thinking back to, this is what I put Stephen through. This is what I put my vote of authority in, saying, go do it to Stephen. And now it's getting done to me. I know how the guy felt. I understand it. I regret it. I can picture this going through his mind. But what we see is after he is stoned, we see the power of God in raising him up, and we see the power of God inside his mind, in his life, because he went back into that city. I can just picture me, if that happened, going somewhere else and licking my wounds and feeling sorry for myself and not loving those people. Paul loved the ones who attacked him. He loved the ones who were against him, and he had the courage, he had the love to go back into them. And can you imagine their thoughts? Okay, we watched him heal that lame man, and now he was dead, and he's back in here. It would have caused quite a stir, but he went back. We don't know the impact, but I don't think it was minor. He went back in. It makes you wonder, how much of an impact can we have in someone's life by not writing them off? Maybe you don't struggle with that. That's one after a while, but it's hard for me. It's so easy to remember what was done in the past, and I can write people off. That's not good. Paul didn't write them off. He went back in. It's a good picture for us. Let's you and I be intentional. Again, make disciples of everyone, not just the ones that we're attracted to or that we like. We need to make disciples of everyone. I'm not going to say it's easy because it's hard, but God can and will enable you to do it. Point F. Last thing, he leaves for Derby. He leaves for Derby. Into verse 20. And the next day, so he didn't stay there long, but the next day he departed with Barnabas to Derby. And when they had preached the gospel to that city and had taught many, we're going to stop there in the middle of the sentence. He departed from it. He left there and went. I'm sorry, I just lost my place. They returned again to Lystra and to Iconium and Antioch. We'll get that next time. Here, when they departed, they went to Derbe and they taught a bunch of people. If you remember the map, it's about a 50-mile walk to get down to Derbe. They made the walk. Now, I would have been discouraged. I'm pretty sure he was sore, but I don't know what was going on in Paul's mind, but I'm going to tell you some thoughts that I think he was thinking that weren't written down for us yet. Philippians. He had learned whatever state he was in, regardless of what was going on, to be content. He knew the truth. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. He knew these truths, and he's going to write them later on, but he needed these. He needed the truth of God ministering in him as he went on this trip. Now we're told in this verse, he went to Derbe and they preached the gospel to that city. They started preaching again. There's this problem coming up and he just keeps preaching the gospel, but he says he taught many. That word taught is the word made disciples. He was seeing people converted. People were being saved. No persecutions mentioned. I don't know if it was there or not. I'll tell you what, I can see people looking at him and hearing what's happened and thinking, persecution is not stopping this guy. Let's find another method because it's not going to help. But persecution is not mentioned here. And he taught many people. That takes time. So we see in these verses the power of God. We see it in Paul's life. Using him, God is using him. He's using Barnabas in very effective ways. God's working. And this is an exciting time, even though the opposition is there. Your application statement at the bottom. As we continue to persevere in our Christian walk, we'll be much more likely to experience God's power. And as we continue to practice humility and to deflect, we must continue to practice humility and to deflect any glory back to our God. God will strengthen us for our task. Lystra was a rough city. It was a hard time for Paul, but God used his work there. People were saved. Churches were established. That's what's going on in Paul's life. I am very thankful that even as I rejected God over the years, God didn't stop drawing me. God didn't quit on me. He kept drawing. Maybe he's doing that for somebody today. Maybe you're here today and God's been working on you. God's been drawing you and you've been kicking against it. You don't have to. You can yield and trust Christ as Savior today. Once he gives us the spiritual life, for those who claim to be saved today, do you realize that he empowers us with everything we need, Peter said, for life and godliness? He gives us everything we need to serve him. People, hear me. There's no excuse you can hide behind. We've got no excuse. He has empowered and given us everything we need to follow him. So when I don't, I'm just rebelling. I'm in sin. That's where we are when we choose not to follow Christ. And we are accountable because we know the truth. Let's stand for it. If you're here today and you have never become a follower of Jesus, understand that God has left you with his testimony. He's given you access to the gospel. You have it. You know it. If you're listening to this message, you know what needs to be done. To reject the plan that God has given us is to reject God. You must receive him. You don't want to reject. I'd love to be able to help you. If you're not sure of your salvation, please pull one of us aside. Let us help you. Christian, life is not all about us. It's not about our desires. It's not about our wishes. It's not about what we want and how we want things done. It's not what life is about. Life is about us bringing glory to our Lord. Most of the time, that happens in our attitudes. You and I need to humbly persevere in the path that God has given to us. That's our responsibility. You do business with God as he does. Close us, please.